there's different ways of looking at it, but in terms of like, if you're on the wrong bus, get off it. In the sense, if you're like, and I understand there's definitely, it's not that easy. It's not easy just to be like, I'm on the wrong bus, get off it. It's in terms of obviously whether that's career, whether that's your college course, whether that's a friend group or whatever.
Hey, I'm Johnny, and you're listening to the Reflections Podcast. Hello and welcome to another episode of the Reflections Podcast. So today, we're headed to the Emerald Isle, the land of saints and scholars, of Guinness and Gaelic football, of jigs, of a language that many struggle to understand, the home of today's guest and myself, Ireland. Now, I feel I don't even need to introduce today's guest to you after hearing him play the banjo there. But he's a good college friend of mine, and he's spreading Irish traditional music around the world and has taught many to play the banjo along with him. My pal James Finnegan studied a BCOMM International along with Mandarin in UCD. He comes from a town in County Monaghan, which is by the border of Northern Ireland and Ireland. And today's focus is on his world of Irish music. He plays the banjo, the mandolin, the guitar, and the tin whistle. And he's got people from all over the world watching his videos and reading his book. This episode was recorded back in UCD just a week before our graduation, but also a week before James started Applegreen's graduate program. Whenever I've had the privilege of spending some time with James, I've been constantly reminded about how uncultured I am in Irish culture, but also how cultured he is. After we recorded this episode, he took me to this movie-like ancient Irish bookstore. In the back of this man's house, I have no idea how James found it, somewhere online. And we spent a few hours looking at these ancient, magnificent books that were hundreds of years old. So wherever you are listening to today's episode, whether you're in the car on the way to work or you're cooking at home, I hope you enjoy and you can enjoy being cultured by James as well. Cheers, guys, and appreciate the support. Perfecto. So welcome, James, to the Reflection Podcast.
Thank you, Johnny. How are you?
I'm great. Good. Feels weird to be back in UCD here with you.
Yeah, first time since the exams in May, yeah.
Yeah. And how's life treating you since
good.
May?
Good. Good summer holidays there. I'm starting work next week, so... Had a few little holidays here and there and a lot of relaxing and chilling and hitting the ground running then next week. So,
yeah. And where are you starting work?
Applegreen, the head office in Dublin. So, 2-year graduate program. So, we'll see where that takes me.
What's the role?
So, graduate program, then you're sort of, it's rotational. So, you're going to spend 6 months in one place and 6 months in another. So, you have 4 different 6 month sort of allotments. So, you could just say, you're in the graduate program, so I don't even know what department I'm going to be in next week. So I'm finding all that out in the first day. So,
wow! Yeah. And for the listeners that don't know, what did you study?
Commerce International. So commerce was about 70% of the degree, and the other 30% then was Mandarin. So did business in Chinese.
Yeah. Wow. And how's your Chinese?
Awful. No, it was an unusual time to be in university because first and second year, well, first year was totally normal in terms of. We'll say the normal college life. I don't know if you can call it normal, but we'll say the standard. And then halfway through second year, as you know, COVID, third year was totally online. But my third year in a, we'll say, no COVID, it should have been in China. So I should have lived in China for the year. So we'll say you look at a Commerce International with Mandarin graduate from 2017, 2018, 2019 versus, we'll say, my graduating year.
Very different.
Very, very different experience in terms of living in China for the year. So it's unfortunate it happened.
Yeah. But, how do you feel about that?
I don't know. At the time, I was like...
Were you excited?
I was excited to go And I wouldn't say I'm a pessimistic person. Well, I probably am. I'd be more of a realist that from like the pandemic sort of got serious in March. It existed in China around December, January. And I was keeping up to date with Chinese news just because of the degree I was interested in it. And by about late February, March, I could see it getting serious. I could see how serious it was in China. It was full on lockdowns at that stage. I was thinking at that stage, I don't think I'm going to get to China in September. And I said that in class and they laughed and said, there's not a hope. And then going into the summer in June, July and August, we were in lockdown. It's like, there's not a hope I'm getting a flight across the world to arguably one of the strictest countries in terms of COVID measures. So I sort of had myself mentally ready not to go to China.
It's funny, I was the polar opposite. I was being the optimist I am. No. I was just like, 2 weeks, give it 2 weeks. It's gone in 2 weeks. I had flights booked. I was in Greece.
I had it in my head that June, July, August, in the summer, I was there like, I might be going to China and it's very likely I won't be. And then it was very much up in the air that UCD and fair play to them, they were holding out to try, but in holding out, we were left in the dark about what's going to happen. So I understand from UCD's perspective that they wanted to hold out as long as possible, hope for
see
a miracle.
What happens.
And then, but in the same token, then there was a lot of ambiguity. Where will I be? If I am in Ireland, will it be online or will it be in person? Mm. If it's online, will it be hybrid? This type of stuff. But I had myself relatively mentally prepared for that then, and things seem to be improving. That there was talk about going in the second semester, going from January till the end. And again, I was a bit more optimistic there, thinking, okay, vaccines are, I think at that stage, vaccines might have been starting. I can't really remember. But again, I was sort of the opinion, I doubt it'll happen. And if it does, cool. But I wasn't going about it, I thinking, oh, it's definitely going to happen. So I think that helped me. I think that, as in having, sort of managing my expectations helped a lot. Because what's the expression? No expectations, no disappointments.
So I
didn't have much expectations about going to China, so that helped.
Yeah, and just to go back a little bit now, to give the listeners a bit of a context to where you come from. Mm-hmm. Where are you from?
I'm from
to depict your accent as well.
Oh yeah, from Monaghan, which is about an hour north of Dublin, along the border between the north and south for any international listeners. So it's an interesting, it's a lovely place. It's very rural. Well, I'm from a rural area anyway. There is obviously big towns and small towns in Monaghan. And moved to Dublin then for college in first year. And so I lived on campus in first year, digs in second year, third year online, and then back up to Dublin then for fourth year. So spent a good bit of time in Dublin this last 4 years.
How do you compare that rural childhood background to moving up to the big smoke in Dublin?
Like, I did look forward to it on a Sunday evening driving to Dublin or getting the bus to Dublin for the week. But in the same way, I looked forward to Friday afternoon getting the bus home. That I think there was definitely...
You go home every weekend?
Every weekend, yeah. For the 4 years, I never spent a weekend in Dublin before. I've never spent a Saturday night in Dublin, ever. That's the truth, yeah. So obviously, then I teach music. So there was that commitment. And then in terms of then family, just getting home... that I coming from, let's say, a rural area, there's little things, like, for example, like I wouldn't say massive culture shocks, but like little things like the whole idea of, like, you could say hello to the bus driver and he'd be like, well, how are you, whereas when you got to Dublin, just throw in the change, don't look at anybody. And like I said, there seemed to be a lot more just because there's that many more people and it's that much busier, that I think there's a bit more anonymity. You're sort of just part of the crowd, whereas in rural area, everyone knows you, and neighbours know neighbours, and it's a bit more of a community.
Yeah, I think that's something that Dublin can work on. In terms of when you say hi to someone, sometimes you don't even get a look back.
Even the simple things, like as in when we're driving, it'd be common enough, like you meet somebody on the road, like the finger lifts, just to be like, I acknowledge, hello, how are you? And if you really know them, the full-on wave, but I get it at the same time that you're on the N11 and there's like 600 people behind you and 700 people in front of you and you're going to work and it's traffic jam. You're not going to.
It's a different world.
It is a different world. So it's not. You're not comparing like with like. Well, I'm not anyway. But there was definitely hustle and bustle and excitement and plenty of people to meet, and there was.
Yeah. Did you know that you wanted to come to Dublin, growing up in Monaghan? What was the plan?
Well, I knew that there's no university in Monaghan. There is the Monaghan Institute of Technology, which is about 45 minutes north of me. Then you've got a few colleges in Dundalk, which would be about a half an hour. And then Dublin, obviously, you've got a good few colleges, Galway, Cork. I think on my CAO, I think I had one and two in terms of my preferences was UCD, and then my third one was Galway. So definitely I'd say the preference was Dublin. And another thing as well is like it's an hour and a half home, which isn't too bad, that you could arguably commute. I never did, but like you could.
Yeah.
Like, as in, it is an hour.
I was so astonished. I thought I was going into the developed Western world, moving to Ireland, and I found that, like, wow, there's so many students commuting in from 2 hours away, and it's 4 hours on a bus every day to come in to study in Dublin.
And it's not cheap either. As in, the buses, they're not too bad, but I think the big thing that lacks is the train network.
Yeah.
If Ireland had better trains, and in terms of that direct line, different places, it'd be a lot better. But yeah, it's not easy, especially like we'll say within 2 hours of Dublin. If you only have 2 or 3 days in college a week, it's not too bad.
Mm.
But like it's sort of a necessity nearly now in terms of the price in Dublin. Like it has got ridiculous. I was quite lucky in my accommodation. I landed on my feet quite well, but I did campus in first year. Not cheap.
No.
Luckily, I've been working for a few summers before that, so that helped a lot. But it's definitely a necessity to commute for a lot. So which definitely changes the college experience as well. That if you're spending your evenings between 3 o'clock and 6, 7 on a bus, depends where you're going, obviously. But a lot can be said for trying to stay relatively close if you can, just try and meet people and have a bit of crack.
Yeah, and talking of meeting people, was it easy to meet people coming into... Did you know anyone coming into college?
There was 100 boys in my year, and 3 of us went to UCD with 3 different schools. So I was in, obviously, School of Business. My friend Michal was in the biomedical science, and then my other friend was doing maths. So we were sort of... You know yourself, in terms of the size of UCD, you might... Yeah. You could do the 4 years and not bump into them ever. No, that could happen.
Well over 30,000 in UCD.
30,000 people. I wouldn't know the exact amount. I think there's probably about 70,000 or 80,000 people in Monaghan. So you're talking about half the population of Monaghan is here. Do you know what I mean? So that from experience, from talking to people from Monaghan, Cav and Louth, it's quite intimidating about UCD, the size, that you think there's that many people, you're going to land on your feet and meet loads of people. And but there's that many people that can really feel a bit lonely, because there is that many people that the person you sit beside in your accounting lecture on a Monday, the following Monday, it's a different person. And that lack of continuity and lack of having, we'll say, a friendship group that you can stick with, that's quite important. But in terms of living on campus is quite a big help in first year, that if someone said after lecture they're going here, there, or on campus, you weren't leaving, you were going to be staying close. So
in terms of making friends.
Yeah, so in terms, and then the freshers week, so the week before starting college, we got put into, I think, a group of 7 people, and then brought around the university to show us where we are, got put into groups and got told what our modules were. I found a lot of people who were put into that group that week tended to gravitate towards those people in the first week.
They were their core.
Which became their friend group.
Yeah.
Which, and so it was unusual that just... by chance, whatever group you were put into in the freshers' week tended to...
It's funny, well, that starting period was so crucial for...
Yeah, like, as in, it's... but I at the same time, I also say that, like, I think my college experience, and yours, obviously, would be different with COVID, that we spent a year at home, saw nobody, that it was nearly difficult to text somebody, oh, what did you do today? I was in lockdown. What were you? I was also in lockdown. It was very hard to have good... conversation and have good crack, that I found throughout the 4 years you can have a good we'll say, I wouldn't say friend group, just people, like your friends, you get on very well with them, you've good crack with them, and then the next, you have your Christmas break, the next semester then, you have different lectures, you have different modules, you didn't meet new people, you're still friendly with the older ones. That I wouldn't say that you have got like a group of three or four people, they're your friends, that's the way it's going to work for 4 years, then you graduate, yeah. And it's constantly changing, and which is a good thing, meeting plenty of people. And
how do you feel your mindset changed from first year to now?
In first year, I probably cared a lot about, like, probably cared a good bit about what the other commerce students thought of me, probably. I don't know, as in, I wouldn't say that was a conscious thought, though. That was probably just, and then I think as time progressed, I really probably started to care less and less and less. And if they did like me, cool. If they didn't, makes no difference to me. Like, I'm still going to, like, yeah. Sort of navigate my way in the world. So I think that compared to first year to final year, probably selfishly probably prioritize myself more in terms of like I need to get X, Y, and Z done for my modules, so I'd prioritize getting a stint done in the library probably more so than other things, which isn't healthy at the same time. Like, you need to make sure that you're getting a decent balance, but like in terms of just in general, I probably started to care less in fourth year just about how others viewed me.
Yeah,
I think in first year you're very conscious about how your friend group likes you, and then there's a lot of new people.
Especially when you're moving in, you're like, okay, I don't know anyone. How am I gonna make friends?
Yeah.
But if we changed our mindset from the get go, then to how am I gonna grow? What's gonna help me to grow?
Mm-hmm.
And I think thinking a little bit selfishly, but I think it's important to think selfishly, in that sense of not. Just not caring about what other people are thinking about you.
Yeah, it was in
just setting your priorities right.
Having your priorities right, and I think we talked about this before a couple of weeks ago.
Mm.
That idea of like, I'm probably going to get the word wrong. Is it like spotlight syndrome? I think it is that obviously like you're the protagonist in your own story. That in terms of like, if your life was a film, if you want to go down the road, like you're the main character, but like. You're not the main character in somebody else's film, in the sense that, like...
That's the danger of the single story.
No, in the sense that, like, that I think it's quite refreshing to realise that, like, nobody really cares what you're up to. Obviously, they care if they're your friend and they want to know what you're up to, but, like, that idea that... of fear of embarrassment.
Yeah.
That the person... You might be embarrassed. The person might acknowledge something that happened for about 2 minutes... 3 minutes, then they're getting on with their life, you're getting on with yours. That if you were to constantly live, that you feel like your life is being viewed by others in a way that's either judgmental or anything, that I think just steer your own ship, plow on, and then, as in, if people are happy about it, cool. If they're not too happy about it, no bother.
That's their issue.
That's their issue.
Not
exactly.
Yours.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So, after COVID, happened in your second year, right?
Yes. Yeah, halfway through second year.
What majorly changed in your mindset then?
So that was unusual in terms of academically, we logged on. So we were doing, what way did it work in second year? We started doing lectures online. It was finished pretty early. Like, we were done our lectures by about 1 o'clock because... obviously, nobody was commuting. Nobody had to worry about navigating whether lecture halls were full or not full. So lectures sort of ran one after another that I was finished most days at about 1 o'clock.
And you hadn't moved anywhere.
I hadn't moved anywhere. You were at home in Monaghan. I couldn't visit my girlfriend. I'm with my girlfriend now for 4 years. You couldn't see aunties and uncles, your grandparents. There was quite a novelty to it. Like, the first 2-3 weeks of COVID was quite exciting. Like, it felt like a bit like a film that, oh, we're locked down, we can't leave. This is weird, isn't it? And then, oh, we were in the shop last week, there was no toilet paper left. Isn't that mad? But it was a bit like, it was a novelty. Whereas the novelty wears off fairly quickly. Like, as in, a month in, it was a bit like, okay, this is getting a bit ridiculous now at this stage. And really strange then that...
Cabin fever,
yeah. And just... it was difficult to get a routine without, because college, again, you finish at 1 o'clock and it's very hard to immerse yourself, for example, in my Chinese things, that to, I'm a huge help in in terms of learning a language, obviously talking to people, like having a tea with them or a coffee,
and especially in normal college life when there's so many things to get involved in on campus, societies, sports, clubs, whatever you're talking about. But we had to figure out how we're gonna spend our spare time.
And it's in that, like, it's in obviously, like, if you've a roof over your head, you're comfortable, and there's not a worry. That is, and it's quite a privileged position to be able to worry just about cabin fever. You're not worrying about how are we going to navigate this now. Obviously, as a student, if anything, I was saving money. Like I said, I wasn't paid rent in Dublin. I was still getting my degree online. That there was positives, obviously the negatives, not seeing people, not mixing with others. But that sort of spawned then the Banjo Buddy thing. So that sort of, there was a bit of a silver lining to it all. So that worked out well for me.
Yeah, so let's unravel the Banjo Buddy a little bit more. How did that come into play?
So COVID hit March 2020, and I teach him for an organization called Kyoltas. So Kyoltas is an organization which is all about promoting and preserving traditional Irish music. So there'd be...
What does Kyoltas mean?
What does Kyoltas mean? That's a good question. I think it's about, like, I think it's spelled C-O-M-H-A-L-T-A-S, Kyoltas.
Oh, gosh.
And I think it might mean community, maybe. Is it a watchy show?
How is your Irish?
Oh, rough enough. It was good. It was in for my leaving cert. It was, I think I got, in higher level, I got a B. I had been to the Gaeltacht three times. I got a scholarship in first year through music and my school. So definitely, that I think I would nearly, this speaking truthfully, I'd nearly rather have fluent Irish than fluent Chinese now, because I don't think in the route I'm taking in my life, I don't think Chinese will be too useful for me. I don't see myself moving there. I don't see myself, maybe commercially, if I even think from Apple Green's perspective, I don't think I'll be doing much Chinese in terms of it's a very Irish, UK, America. I don't see them breaking into the Chinese market. That from a sort of a cultural identity thing, it'd be lovely. As in, I definitely enjoyed it in secondary school, and you know yourself, that if you don't use it, you lose it. I haven't spoken at all.
You just got to practice it.
I think immerse yourself.
Yeah.
Instead of heading to Beijing for the year, head to Connemara. That'd be better for me.
Yeah. But, so anyway, Kyoltas.
Yeah. So I was working for Kyoltas. Yeah. And so I have basically it's group classes. I was the teacher, so I still am. I still work for them. Had group classes, and I was very fortunate growing up that my father plays Irish music, my grandfather plays Irish music, my sister plays Irish music, that there was definitely that idea that if I didn't go to lessons for 3, 4, 5, 6 weeks, there'd still be music in the kitchen. My mother worked for Bose when I was a child, like the speaker company. So when at a Christmas raffle, I think in like 2001 or two, she won a surround sound speaker set. So above our kitchen cabinets in my kitchen, we have surround speakers that connect to the CD player. Now it's connected to our phones. That there was just always music in the house, always. My father used to have a little thing that you put 6 CDs into it and you press shuffle. And that was like Spotify. Like, you didn't know what song was next, but it was going to be one of the 6 CDs. But obviously things have changed now.
First ever shuffle.
Yeah, exactly. Before the little iPods. But so there was always music. It was definitely. I'd say obviously as a child I hadn't played music yet. So, but
when did you start playing music?
About the age of 7. Yeah, and then even. We'll say my sister started probably when she was about 6 or 7, and I'm 2 years younger. So I was even hearing my sister learn when I was 4.
So what do you play?
So started off with the tin whistle, which I think every young Irish child learns eventually in school. And then I remember the day I got my banjo very well, but I don't remember asking for it. But I did ask for it. I don't remember that conversation, as in my father asked, "What instrument do you want?" Not like, do you want to play another instrument? Like, what one? And for some reason, picked the banjo. Don't know why. I assume I could have been listening to, like, Barney McKenna would be like the Jimi Hendrix of banjo. Like, he was from the Dubliners. So probably listened to him the day before. For some reason, I said Barney McKenna. Oh, sorry, I said banjo. We were away then on up in Bundoran, and I came home and there was a banjo underneath my duvet in my bed. In the bed there was a banjo on the sun. I thought someone
You're
was
a lover.
Ironically as well, there was the Incredible Hulk. There was an Incredible Hulk mask at the top. So it looked like that was the head, and then the banjo was the body. So I thought the Hulk was in my bed. But got the banjo. I think I was about I was seven. And like I can't lie, like as in my father would have been like very much like instrumental in like, I would have started lessons probably about 3 or 4 weeks later, but in the meantime, like he would have like, okay, hold it like this. He wouldn't have played the banjo, but he would have saw a lot of people playing over his lifetime. Okay, you're gonna hold it relatively like this. There's the E string, there's the A string, there's the D string. That these little things.
Did he teach you everything?
No. He sort of got me on the right track. Found a teacher that, like, when I went into the teacher, I had little snippets of information that I had found out from dad. That then when I got home, then he'd sit down after dinner. Okay, show me what you've been practicing today. But having that interest at home was absolutely fundamental. Like, as in that. I find now
a willingness to practice.
Well, listen, I wouldn't even say that I was a saint for practicing. Like, I was told, like, practice, and then there was always that threat as well. If you don't practice, the banjo's going to be sold. And then I'd be like, oh no, I will practice, and then you pick it up very quickly. I'd assume it was an empty threat. Like, as in, I don't think the banjo was
pushed you.
I would say though, like, I didn't see it as being pushed. I got told to practice. I practice. I didn't really go against the grain. There's probably days I didn't practice. That's just the way life works.
Yeah,
but I find it now teaching music that, like, some parents are giving their children instruments for the sake, whether they practice, don't practice, they're indifferent, that the child or the becomes an adult, they're 28. Oh, I always wish I could play an instrument. I took you to lessons. I did. I give you that opportunity. The more so, I think, trying to tick the box that the opportunity was given to them, that whether they're good, bad, whether they practice or don't practice, there's not that interest to sit down and listen to them practice, encouragement. Like, you can't be being encouraged, especially as a child. Like, as in, I teach adults now as well. It's a very different ball game. Like, they're doing it for themselves. They could be retired. They have plenty of time in the evening. That's different. But as a child, that guidance, that encouragement, I think, is just really, really important.
And it's just about having fun while doing it as a child, right?
And, like, as in, definitely there would have been that element, I'd say, as a child as well, of, like, showing off, probably. Like, as in, if you were practicing, then you could bring it out when the grandparents come over to show them what you've been working on. And obviously then having the grandfather as a musician, that's what I was just saying, that in terms of having the right sort of community around you as well, very, very important. But that's what I said, I digressed there totally, but basically working...
So back to banjo, buddy.
Back to banjo,
how did that come into fruition?
Yeah, so then I was saying, quote this, that I found a lot of my students in that didn't have that family passion for music. So I started putting videos on YouTube during lockdown so that my cultist students, probably about 15 or 20 students, could play along with me at home. So they mightn't have had siblings playing, they didn't have parents playing. So I posted a few videos on YouTube, very simple tunes. I put the notes on the screen of me playing. So a bit like karaoke, play along with me, expecting my 15 or 20 cultist students to look at it.
So this was because you couldn't do it in person?
Because I couldn't do it in person, exactly. And then I was literally bored. I had very little to do. I was finished college at 1 o'clock in the day. So I started writing a book of how to play the banjo. And that was, how can I pass time? As in, I'd sit on the couch, dressing gown on, laptop on my lap, and just type away. So that passed a lot of time. And then 5 subscribers turned into 10, 10 turned into 50, 100. 200. I was chuffed with 200. Like, I by no means now trying to come, like, as in, it's not viral. Like, as in, I'm not like I'm garnering, like, as in, I think at this stage, I think about 4,000 subscribers. So in terms of, for a community of Irish tenor banjo players, it's very, wow, that's brilliant. Like, as in, that there's this, I think, idea of YouTube, like, that if you don't have 1 million subscribers, then is in my idea that if I have 4,000 who genuinely enjoy the content, and they're getting good use of it, and they're enjoying it, I'm chuffed. Like, as in,
that's the thing as well. If you've taught one person how to play the banjo, you've had a big impact on that person's life.
Yeah, no, as in, my banjo teacher, as a child. He's actually living in Egypt, and I haven't talked to him in a long time. And I do often think about that, being like, that this skill, this life skill has been given to you by somebody. And it is very nice to be able to pass it on and to know
that. It's so cool that you're spreading Irish culture around the world.
Yeah, Irish culture. And then, they're saying, then I started putting my email address on the videos. So now, I think at the height of COVID, when nobody in the world had anything to do, about 40 or 50% of my students were Americans, British, Canadian. So yeah, it was nice to...
So what was the process of writing the book like?
It was...
Where do you start?
I think the first thing I did was like, if I was a beginner, if I didn't know, basically I was talking to myself in the sense of like, okay, let's rewind 10 years. What would you cover? So I just basically wrote down like the content list in the sense of like, okay, right-hand technique, left-hand technique, the notes of the banjo, how do you hold it? And I wrote down all these things. And then within all the headings, then I wrote down the bullet points of what's important. Very lucky as well, again, about community. My auntie Sinead's a very gifted artist. Hmm. So I took pictures of myself. I took pictures of myself playing. And I told her, okay, I want you to pencil sketch me doing. So for example, my right hand, I want you to sketch that. My left hand, I want you to sketch this. That I wanted to be able to color coordinate things within her sketches. And I thought it was a lot more real than just pictures on the iPhone, stick them in the book. Yeah. That I liked having the hand sketches as well. I thought that was nice to put in. So
it's cool from a designer.
Yeah,
too.
And I liked the look. It was a nice aesthetic as well. So basically wrote up the headings, wrote bullet points under each heading, got my auntie Sinead to do the pictures. And like, you're talking like Microsoft Word, wrote it up. Probably took me about a month and a half, 2 months. But again, I had nothing to do. Like, that's the real important thing there.
Just finding the time.
I had everything. Sorry, I had nothing but time.
Yeah.
That was it. Like, so spent my evenings doing that. So then what I did was, on my YouTube video, I said, "Hi, you folks. This week we're going to cover this tune. By the way, I've got a banjo book, How to Play the Banjo, coming out. And if you're interested in it, just drop me an email." And like, no e-commerce page, no website. And then I got my first customer was from Florida. Florida, yeah.
Well.
Yeah, it wasn't even from Monaghan. Like I said, I'd say half my students didn't even buy the book. Like I said, so like I said, the guy, he said, "Hello there. You mentioned that you're printing a book, and I'd like to buy it." And I was like, "That's brilliant." I didn't even have stock at that stage. Like, I just had as a PDF, I emailed some printers, and then about 3 hours later, another guy, I think maybe from like London, "Oh yeah, I see you're printing a book." So then I think I ordered 50.
Yeah.
I said, "I want 50 books from the printer." Maybe a week later, they arrived at the house. So it all went from there then. So
you've definitely got it to your advantage that there's so many Irish people that have left over the
course
of history. Yeah, so they're like, "Oh, I need to get my Irish roots back and learn the banjo."
Totally, the Irish diaspora. I think 44, is it like 44 million people identify as Irish, and 4 million people or 5 live in the country.
Exactly.
So it could be even more. I'd say it's probably more.
The stat that I always tell people is there's 5 million people in Ireland, and there's 50 million Irish passports in the world.
Yeah.
That's including my family in South Africa,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
I think all you need is one grandparent to be born in Ireland to classify
as
an Irish citizen. So
So definitely, as in, I think that's a big part of it as well, that... Again, connecting that, okay, well, my grandfather will say was from, if they're in America, my grandfather was from Kerry. They look at some Irish videos to see a banjo. And then again, it depends where they are. They mightn't have the right any Irish traditional music resources like in person. So obviously everyone gravitates to YouTube. So again, probably at 500 subscribers at this stage, probably selling 2 or 3 books a week. And I was chuffed. I was like, wow.
So what was the marketing for the book like?
Very, very natural. It was not really pushed. To this day, I've never paid for marketing, ever, to this day. So basically, I would make a video to teach a tune. I'd plug the book at the start, and the end of the video would be like, I'm going to teach you this tune. And by the way, if you want more tips and advice, it's in my book. And sort of went from there then. And then people started to post my videos in Facebook groups, which got more viewers, which got more books. And yeah, so it sort of, it was a more of a community of like-minded musicians who saw the benefit of it rather than me trying to shove it down people's
and
throats.
Did you envision that final product at the start, or you
no,
just
no I thought I was making the banjo book hopefully that it would be my resource for teaching music as I progress in my life, that if I take on a new student next week, I have a couple of months of resources condensed into a book, and we'll basically, the two of us will go through the book then, that, and the idea then that I could actually sell it to people that I'll never ever meet is, was like, wow, it's an option. And then that's just the power of online and the power of PayPal and all those type of things.
Yeah. And did you use platforms other than YouTube as well?
So then I sort of realized that what's the point in hoping people post my videos on YouTube, that I started my own private, Facebook. I started my own private Facebook account, and then that day I did the Banjo Buddy Facebook account. So then I sort of took more of an active role then in trying to get the videos into group chats. When I say group chats, like just chat forums with maybe 1,000 aspiring banjo learners or 2,000. And that I think if I was to post a video, especially at the start, you might get like, and again, this is very small scale. Like I said, you might have got
it's
like
small scale, but you never know what doors that might open.
Might have got 150, 200 views. You get it into the right group chats, then the views might go up to 2,000. And then again, more eyes on you, then more people who might be interested in your book, and then more people who might be interested in lessons. Like majority of my students now, the vast majority, even relatively locally, they come across you on YouTube, or you happen to live near them, they come to you. Then otherwise, then
you just have a bit more recognition.
And then a big thing I've noticed as well is that there's a lot of trad summer schools and festivals.
Yeah.
And then, there are dozens upon dozens of very reputable, talented, very good banjo players. And then just by having the YouTube channel, having the book, having then the second tune book, which was really my sort of my passion project over COVID, you're getting emails now, our summer school's happening our trad school's happening the first weekend of October, will you be the banjo teacher? Little things like that, like you're and again, not even from a financial point of view, just to be asked, it's lovely to have that opportunity. And I would have went to all those schools when I was a child, that it's nice to...
So how have you balanced this trade-off between your passion of music and your business world?
In terms of
career, academics, what you want to do versus what you...
What I would say is that...
Have to do.
I'm quite blessed in the sense that I post a video, it could take me a half a day to make it, easily. It could take a full day in terms of, well, actually make it, the recording the video, editing it, in terms of, it's a bit like, as I mentioned already, a bit like karaoke. I have the notes on the screen. That a lot of work goes into the video. It's not just put the camera on the table, video myself, upload it. Like I spend far more time editing the video than I do actually recording it.
Yeah.
That from that video then it might get 200 views, then a bit more, then a bit more, then a bit more. That the work's done, then I can focus then on, for example, I'm starting my job next week.
How will you find the time to continue with the...
Well, it's a bit like if you want to go for a run, or if you want to play soccer with the lads, or you want to, like, as in, I'll spend an evening making a video. Hopefully then, that's what I'm saying, is in that the video isn't on YouTube, obviously, for that evening. It's going to be there forever. So I would say that I might get a book sale today from a video I published 6 months ago. Do you know what I mean? So that is in, it's nice that, that when you post, you're getting the dividends of that, possibly in months from now. That it isn't, it'd be a lot more challenging if my lessons were live and the people had to be there on time. That was it. Whereas the fact that they're there, you want to watch it today or tomorrow or in a month's time or 6 months' time. That I think that another thing as well is that I have weekends off now from work. And if I can make 3 or 4 videos in a weekend, try and spread them out evenly over a period of time. That I think that... It's a bit like I enjoy doing it. I really find it fulfilling. I not even financially, and financially it is nice, but in terms of like sort of reaching out to aspiring players across Europe, Australia, Canada, America, that it is very nice to get an email from a person for a very simple question, and you feel like, oh, they felt that from watching my videos that I had some type of knowledge that I could share with them. So in that regard,
is that your main why?
A huge why at the start. The why at the start was to try and help my own students. It wasn't the case that I want to have, like I said, I never thought I'd have one subscriber from America, whereas now my book sales, I think 60% go to America.
Wow.
Yeah, no, it's funny that, like, but my why in terms of the videos was to help the local students, who, my 20, 25 students locally. The why in terms of the tune book, so I followed them with a second book, which is a book of 365 Irish musical pieces, so basically, hypothetically, someone could learn a tune a day for a year if they wanted to. My why there was that I got great solace. I enjoyed, because I learned this tune when I was 10. I'm gonna write it out now, and it's gonna look pretty. It's gonna look well. It's gonna be done. So then I wrote one, and it wasn't a case of writing a book. I just wanted to write the tunes that I had learned. These aren't my compositions. These are tunes that might have been first recorded in the 1920s and ones that have appeared in publications from the 1800s that I wrote out a tune. It took me about a day and a half, 2 days to write it out, as in I wasn't familiar with the technical end of sort of the intricacies associated with music in terms of, we'll say, the dots, the sheet music, the crotchets and quavers and semi-quavers. I would have been very much an oral tradition.
More practical
teacher plays, I repeat, as in my teacher used to say, monkey see, monkey do. As in, just copy just as best as you can. And then another way of learning would be through ABCs, so the tunes would be written out alphabetically. There's different ways you can learn that music. That I wanted to have the one sheet of paper with the different ways you can learn a piece of music that would suit, well, for example, the American customer or the American viewer who learns using tab, the British consumer who learns using sheet music, the Irish consumer who learns using ABC. So I produced this one tune. It took me about 2 days to do it, and I enjoyed doing it. I really enjoyed it. Again, couldn't visit anybody, couldn't do anything. So I did it a second time, and I did it the third time. And I had about three jigs, and there's different types of tunes, jigs, reels, polkas, hornpipes. So I said, sure, I'll write out if I can all the jigs I can think of. So I spent about 3 weeks, and again, I'd log off from college, maybe take the dog for a walk, have dinner, and then get the laptop out. And
when you've got passion for something, doesn't feel like work.
It was 4 o'clock, you'd write, you'd get a cup of tea, you'd write again, all of a sudden it's 11:30, and you're like, whoa. It was really, really enjoyable. And then I probably had about 110 jigs that I wrote out. It took a day, like it took weeks. And I was there like, keep going, I'll do my reels now. And then all of a sudden, I think I counted then, at that stage, I think I had notated like 302 tunes over the space of a few months. And again, it was for myself that if I have a student and they want to learn nearly any tune, I have it prepared. I did it during lockdown, it's done. It was for myself. And I thought to myself, I could compile all these together, have a book, have a tune a day. So I only had to notate about another 60 tunes then, and so got the 365, basically compiled the PDFs together, emailed a few printers, got a few prices, and then I set up my website then, because it was getting a bit awkward. A person would email me they want it, I'd email them back, where are you from, they'd email me where they're from. Whereas if you could have a e-commerce and
difficult
admin.
And did you get much guidance throughout the process of the execution?
Yeah, was in one of my great friend of mine, Ellen Gibling, and she's a harpist from Nova Scotia, and like I'd be there like on a FaceTime with Ellen. I'd be like, Ellen, between this note and this note, I know I need to hold the note for two bars or two beats, or however long it was, and I don't know on this software how to do that. And she wouldn't have been too familiar with it either. She's like, oh, that's a crotchet. And like, I wouldn't have known that. I would have been very, very, very much of a practical do it, but But to actually communicate what I'm doing, I was very bad at that. I didn't do music in secondary school. I didn't do music in, I did music in primary school on the tin whistle, as in the Mary Had a Little Lamb, Happy Birthday, all those type of things. Mm-hmm. But Ellen and my girlfriend studied music. They would have been very helpful in terms of just being like, oh, what's happening there is you're writing this, but you should write this instead. And they were helpful then. And then the printer in Carrick, it was Farney Print in Carrick Cross, they were very good to me as well, in the sense of being like, okay, if you have the paper too thin, you can be able to see on both sides what's going on. It won't look good. If you go for this bind and it's not durable. So in that sense as well, they were helpful, that there was people helping me in terms of the actual content, people helping me in terms of the actual production of it. And another thing as well is that from a copyright perspective, if the composer was living, I would have, if someone wrote a tune book and my tune was in it, I'd be like, oh, he included my book or my tune, or she included my tune. Whereas some people could think this person's selling a book which has my content in it. So all the living composers, there's about 25 of them, and some of them very, very reputable and very famous and well known in the community, well known in tradition. So even that was an experience in itself, to email these famous, and when I say famous in my world, isn't it? Yeah. Maybe they could walk down O'Connell Street and be recognised once, as in, you know what I mean? As in, it's quite, well, I wouldn't say Irish music's niche, but it mightn't be mainstream, but emailing different musicians from America and all over Ireland and the UK and France, and just be like, this is my project, I'm in college, I'd love to use your book, I'd love to use your tune, sorry. And I think all bar one was like, yeah.
Yeah. By the way, did you have anyone around you that had an entrepreneurial mindset, like from your family?
Well, my father's a farmer, which would be, I would say, entrepreneurial in the sense you always have to make sure that things aren't moving as efficiently as they can be, and there's, I would say, well you could say cost saving, but not at the expense of animal welfare, making sure everything's going the way it should be going. Well, what I would say is that not necessarily entrepreneurial, but there was very much a sense of like, if I said I'm going to do this and this, it was a case of, yeah, cool. There was never a case of, why would you bother doing that? So
open-mindedness,
and I think that my father especially, like, he'd see me sitting on the couch with headphones on me, and I'd sit down at 4 o'clock and I mightn't get up till 10, and he knew then, oh, he's happy enough there doing what he's doing. And but that's what I'm saying, at the start it was a case of like really enjoying doing it, and then when it was all, the work was done, realizing, okay, I actually can compile this all together now and get in touch with composers and get it actually printed.
And having exposed yourself to this entrepreneurial side, how do you feel about going to Apple Green?
I'm excited. Like, I'm excited that my main thing I'm hoping to get of Apple Green is that my exposure to the world of business, in the sense of business from the e-commerce. Well, it would say theory based from university, and then from the Banjo Buddy's perspective, it's been very much like individual. And I'm looking forward, from Apple Green's perspective, seeing how managers lead, seeing how teams work, seeing how different departments communicate together. That I think that if I was to, we'll say, pursue the Banjo Buddy full time, it's quite a, I wouldn't say a lonely pursuit, but I wouldn't mind experiencing the corporate world.
You're just chucking all your eggs into one basket.
And as in, I think that it is possible to experience that. It's a 2-year contract.
Yeah.
See, as in, put the theory, hopefully the theory of UCD into practice in the corporate world. And then, and again, I could be in the middle of working on a normal day in Apple Green, and the e-commerce is still, it's still live, it's still up there. Yeah. So as in,
it's not like you're forgetting that.
No, and I think that as in, once YouTube still exists and the videos are still there, hopefully it'll be sort of always sort of hopefully paying out dividends now and then.
Yeah. And have you learned a lot from college as a foundation to going into Apple Green?
To be honest, I don't know yet, because I haven't done a day in Apple Green, so it's very hard to be like, because when I do this and this, I find college helps. Like, I don't know yet.
Yeah.
I do think that doing is the best form of learning, that you have to throw yourself in there. And I found that college isn't necessarily doing. Like, writing an essay about good management isn't being a good manager. Yeah. And writing an essay...
You need to talk the talk, but walk the walk.
Yeah. As in, I find that college, it is a lot that, like, if you can write well and you can reference well and you give back the lecturer what they give you, you could leave here with a good result.
It's all about how you play your cards.
Play your cards.
Well. And I think getting an all-round view of college life.
Yeah.
So, and that means getting involved, doing your... whatever you're passionate about, get writing a book about playing the banjo.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I don't know how much UCD has prepared me for Aberdeen yet. I do think that I'll probably learn a lot more about the intricacies of a big corporation in a month of an Aberdeen than a semester in college, just because you're doing it. But in the same token as well, had I not gone and had I not done commerce, never mind in UCD, like, no matter where, like, you needed to have the degree to get into the line, to get into the job. So what you mean is, I can't be like, the degree.
It's the system.
It's a system. You can't be like, I wish I went directly into the corporate world, because that bridge doesn't exist yet.
Yeah.
And I don't know if it ever will exist. And it seems to be the necessary prerequisite to get into the job.
Yeah. And... in hindsight, what principle would you have told yourself going into first year?
What would I tell myself? Don't take yourself too seriously, because nobody else has probably taken me too seriously, so don't take yourself... the main thing is, like, we mentioned this already, Dick, as in, don't really care about too much about what people are thinking about you. Just do what, like, as in... do what you're passionate about. Like, in my case, it was music. I really enjoyed it. And another thing as well is that my father used to always say, and it's both, we'll say, literal advice and metaphorical, he does always say, if you're on the wrong bus, get off it. In the sense that if you find that you're going down the wrong path, whether you're doing modules you don't really like, you're in a friend group that you're not too sure about, you're literally on the wrong bus. Get off it. Like, I said, get off, reassess the situation.
But you can also find a lot of value on being on that wrong bus, because then you know you're on the wrong
bus. Yes, definitely.
Sometimes you can think that is the wrong bus is over there, but you can get on it and you'd be like, oh, I'm actually going on the right path.
Yes, yeah. But as in, I think to know that, like, I don't think it would have been wise. I did think at times thinking, would I be better off going another route than this course, than finishing at UCD. And my father, as in, it was always the case. Like, as in, when I go home on a Friday evening, how was college this week? Good. Are you on the right bus? Yeah. That was the question. Like, well, really? That was it, yeah. And still, even to this day, I have a feeling when I get home from Aberdeen on Friday, it'll be, how was work this week? Good. Are you on the right bus?
Thanks. It's so important to constantly remind yourself, though.
Yeah,
that you're...
and it's good. As in, I'm getting a bit older now that, as in, obviously... you're flying the nest, you're doing your own thing, but it's nice, especially when you're at university, to know you can sit down and be like, actually, no, I'm not on the right bus, and I'm not on the right course, I'm not in the right thing, and I want to change that. And if you have that pressure at home that you can't leave what you're doing, for maybe fear of embarrassing, fear of letting people down, that is in, just always being conscious that, like,
what do you believe one can do to just ensure that you are on that right bus?
Just as in, the whole idea, I think, of this podcast is just reflect on what's happening, right? But as in, just take, as in, I'm not going to lie and sit here and be like, oh, I journal every evening. I don't do anything like that. And in terms of just...
do you have daily habits?
It's been a fairly relaxing summer. teaching a bit of music. I went to a few holidays here and there. Like, as in, finished exams in May. That was it, and you know yourself, it was a tough couple of weeks, a tough couple of months, really, from September to May, preparing for all that stuff.
Was Bookwork still going then? It was out, but were you still producing videos for Banjo?
Really, like, I had a few videos up. And, like, they were always getting views, and it was really, really, and again, not only financially rewarding, like, it's in the financial end of things, definitely it helps and it's rewarding, but you're in the middle, you're in the library and you're writing an essay on some random thing on management and your phone vibrates and you look and somebody in United Arab Emirates has just bought your boot. And it's not a case of like, oh, it's lovely, it's a bit extra. It's like, oh, someone in this country is getting value from my videos, or yeah, is in. There's some random ones like French Polynesia, Hawaii, Alaska, I think I got Tasmania yesterday. Like these, wow, are, but like I said, that is sort of, it's more of a, oh, cool. Like I said,
that must feel so damn cool to know that this book that you wrote, yeah, that you put you're sweating tears through, yeah, it's all over the world.
No, and it's nice to think as well, that as things will get busier now, next week, yeah, realistically, in terms of, you know, yourself, we're graduating next week, and then the getting into a real job in the sense of that type of thing. That I know that had it been a normal college experience in the sense of no COVID, I would never have done it, and I would have never had the time to do it. Mm. Then I look at it now, I think to myself, how did I do it? In the sense of, like, I would never do it again from scratch. The size of the book, it's like it's 450 pages.
Mm.
That, just having that time, and just to do it. The tunes, it's not like fruit and vegetables, they're not going to go out of date, like they're here forever. So that I'm not even too apprehensive when I order the books, like I said, my first ever order of my first banjo book, I ordered 50 and I was praying I could sell them all. Whereas now if I order 500, I'm like, they'll go eventually. Like,
yeah,
it might take a couple of years, it might take several years, but like, as in,
showed you that
there's a market, there's demand there. And then again, some days I might sell one, some weeks I might sell none. It just depends.
Yeah. And I know you said that if you started from scratch now, you might not do it. But if you're someone listening and you might have an idea, but you're worried about executing, would you have any advice for them?
Just get stuck in. A good start is half the work, because I'm just literally, give it a go. Like, what is the worst? The worst case scenario with me was that the worst case scenario was that if I didn't start, I wouldn't have this thing. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But as in terms of, like, even if it doesn't go well for you in a commercial sense, like, the lessons I learned from getting in touch with composers, from communicating with the different people, and then just the actual enjoyment of doing it. Like, I really, yeah, really, really enjoyed doing it. That I would say, I think it was, not to be stealing quotes from people, I think it was a Jim Carrey was talking about his father, who was supposed to be a very funny man and could have done comedy, but he became an accountant, and then the accountancy firm went bust, and he said that he says there's a chance in life that you could fail at what you don't want, so you may as well fail at what you do want to do. Yeah. Give it a go anyway, like, as in, just get stuck in.
No regrets.
And then worst case scenario,
yeah,
doesn't work out, just dust yourself off, give something else a go.
Yeah,
it'll be all right. We will get there eventually. Like I said, there's a, again, that's all about not taking yourself too seriously. Just, yeah, see what happens.
Yeah. And did you have any misconceptions of what college would be like? Like, going into first year, had you thought differently?
I think I probably thought that there would be a lot more, I think, larger friend groups. Probably thought, like, oh, you're gonna, like, fall in with a group of 30 and you're gonna have great fun with them all the time. Where I think it was a lot more smaller scale, like 3 or 4 or 5. There definitely probably was friend groups of 30. I just, yeah, didn't happen to find myself in them.
Yeah.
I thought that's my own fault. but like,
but you can find a lot of meaning in those,
yeah,
those smaller groups.
Yeah, and, like I said, I find that, like, and then in terms of, like, I probably a big misconception, and I don't think it's necessarily a reflection of UCD, or I think it could be a reflection of college full stop. I thought that you walk into the degree 18 years old and you walk out at 22 just absolutely ready for the world of rock, employable.
Yeah.
You have the skills, you have the knowledge, time for execution. Whereas I find that it's a necessary prerequisite to get in. And you learn when you get in. Do you know what I mean? Like I said, I don't know. I couldn't tell you. These are the tangible skills I have that university's provided me.
There were so many people that said in the book, when answering that question, was, yeah, everyone is just an adult out here, like me right now. I'm like, that's a little scary.
Yeah.
You know, when we're kids, we think, oh, adults, they're so wise and they know it all. And then you realize you're an adult too, and you're like, Oh shit, I know nothing.
Yeah. I had to pick up my goddaughter. She's my little cousin from the creche. And there was a little guy there, he's probably about 5, and the woman said, "Oh, he's in the same school you went to." I said, "Oh, very good, very good." I says, "Oh, it's a great school. You went to that school? That school was there when you were young." I was like, "It wasn't that long ago." Like, he couldn't comprehend
already,
the school.
Yeah.
I was like, "Oh my God, we're getting old." I said, "No," but I said, "I think just that knowledge that like a lot of people our age on the same path, trying to navigate the world in terms of trying to get into a job, hopefully that we enjoy." And again, as in that's what I'm saying, as in that it's not a case, like I'm looking forward to the corporate end of things to see what way big companies are run, try and learn about hopefully how people manage, about teams, how all these different parts of things come together, and then could stay there for a long time, enjoy that, could bring that knowledge elsewhere, who knows, could go into the Banjo Buddy full time, who know, I don't know, I don't know, it's sort of a...
So you give it, the grad program's 3 years?
2 years.
2 years?
2 years, yeah. So it's four 6 month rotations. So 6 months here, and 6 months here.
And do you see yourself staying on after that? You don't know, you're totally
it's
open?
It's very hard to answer that today, because I've never worked a day there in my life.
Yeah.
It's funny, like I got the job, you know yourself, just in terms of the general vibe of fourth year, there's that many grad programs and jobs that there's in, a lot of them finished like last November. That like I think I got my job in January. Like, I've been telling people for 9 months, "Oh, I'm going to work for Applegreen."
Yeah.
I meet people then months later, "How's Applegreen?" "I don't know yet. I still haven't started." Like I said, that I think I can answer your question better.
Yeah.
When I've worked there a month or 2 months or 3 months, but I've had Zoom calls, I've had email correspondence, and so
far. Do you have goals for yourself?
I would have. Not totally like as in, "Oh, I want to reach X amount of subscribers by Christmas," or "I want to," like, I just want to enjoy just as in the day to day existence of just go. As in, once I've enjoyed myself, hopefully, good colleagues, I've a wonderful girlfriend, there's 4 years, good family around me, that is in that I wouldn't say, "Oh, by 25, I want to be on this amount of money in my salary," or "I want to sell X amount of books per month." As in, not like that, because I find then that if I go down that route with the books especially, that I think the novelty of a random country buying it could wear off if you're thinking about, okay, well, what's the bottom line then in terms of what's the profit looking like? As in again, as I was saying to you, I'm far more pleased that somebody random in a random state in
having a sense of gratitude is so important.
Yeah.
And I think to be able to have an optimistic view on life, you need that sense of gratitude.
Mm-hmm.
That's something that I do every morning, is I write one thing that I'm grateful for.
Yeah, I think you're definitely far more of an optimist than I am.
I think so.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely.
But
yeah.
That's why people get along. Yeah, we're different.
Yin and yang.
We learn from each other too.
Yeah. Oh, is it? Have you got anything, would you say then, in terms of the different outlook from high school to college, that is in mindset change?
Oh, on a personal level, I learned so much moving from South Africa, age 18, to Ireland.
Very different experience than me.
And, well, you had it on a level from moving from Monaghan to Dublin.
Yeah,
you didn't know many people in Dublin either.
Well,
but
you went across the world.
That is true.
Like, it was like an hour in the car. Yeah. So.
But yeah, I didn't, although I always said I was Irish in South Africa, I moved to Ireland and all of a sudden I was known as the South African guy.
Yeah,
that was my identity. And trying to navigate that and make friends was a lot harder than I initially thought.
Mm-hmm.
I had expectations like, "I'm Irish, I want to make friends with Irish people." And it took time. It took time. I spent 10 months before college in Ireland just working, saving money, made good friends. And then I learned a lot when I started traveling on my own.
Mm-hmm.
But even just taking that leap and coming to Ireland, I really learned about myself, and I've always been...
What did you learn?
So I grew a lot because I knew that I was a very extroverted person,
mm-hmm.
and I always got a lot of energy off of other people, but I was never able to spend time by myself.
Mm-hmm.
And the first time I'm like, okay, I actually don't have any friends in this place, so I'm going to make friends, but it's also important to be able to enjoy time on your own.
Yeah, definitely.
From time to time.
Yeah.
And that's what I learned about myself a lot. I was like, got to know myself, and hey, I've got, I can have fun with myself, which is, sounds very bad, doesn't it?
I get you. No, as in, I get you though. As in, be able to be comfortable in your own company.
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
And you can't love other people unless you don't love,
yeah,
love,
yeah,
yourself.
I get you. No, definitely. No, but.
Yeah, so I learned a lot, and to a similar context to you, I think you grow a lot when you chuck yourself out there.
Yeah.
When you get out of that comfort zone, and you're around new faces, you're learning from new people, from different kinds of perspectives, from not from home. Encouraging yourself to develop in your IQ,
mm-hmm.
but you're also your EQ,
yeah.
and your CQ. So you're,
go on, CQ.
CQ is cultural intelligence.
Okay,
so,
that's new to me.
So that's what I believe travel really does enhance. And it's just being able to put yourself in someone's shoes, that's EQ, but because of their culture and where they're coming from.
Yeah, very good. Never, EQ. No, I knew EQ and IQ. CQ is new to, is there any more Qs?
I heard Malcolm Gladwell talk about PQ, practical intelligence. So that's like being able to put together a TV and reading the manual, which I never even bothered with. You know, the effort.
Yeah, the IKEA type of thing.
Exactly.
Flat pie. Yeah, I get you. Okay.
Yeah.
Very good.
I said putting a TV together. You don't really do that.
Like, yeah,
it's just because there's a TV in this room.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I get you. I get you. No, I don't. Yeah. PQ.
PQ. Yeah. So I've asked you about your goals, but in the long run, what kind of legacy do you want to leave?
Oh, wow. Like, I'd be of the opinion that when you're gone, you're gone. Like, I'm thinking, I sort of want to make sure I'm happy, make sure the family around me is happy, make sure the people that are important to me are happy, that I'd rather do that than at the expense of trying to push something at a legacy, because I'm not around anyway, to really sort of, that, as in, I wouldn't stay up at night thinking about what legacy would be left.
Yeah.
As in, it's quite nice, like, as in that, it's quite nice to know that when I'm long gone, hopefully not for a long time, but when I am long gone, that in a random bookshelf in New Zealand, there'll be a book from 2020, 2021 from a fellow called James Finnegan. And it's nice to know that, I think it's 28 countries now it's in, that
that's awesome.
You imagine that there's a bit of peace here then. That, and then it was nice as well. I got an order last year. It was the woman's name, and it was the Irish Traditional Music Archives, and it was in Dublin. And I emailed and I was like, oh, I noticed your sale, thank you very much. And she said, oh yeah, we're putting your book in the archives, just in the Irish Traditional Music Archive. And just knowing that no matter what happens, whether the books sell out next year and I never print another one, and I go into Applegreen and I teach music a bit, and I just have a very sort of, we'll say, standard work, and I enjoy it, that there's definitely a sort of a piece of what I worked on when I was in college around. But in terms of legacy, hopefully people can say, oh, he always knew what was important in life and he stuck to that, and that type of thing is in. But again, I wouldn't sort of be sort of waking up in the morning and thinking, okay, how can I keep the legacy, how can I build this legacy, as it that would really be on my mind at all, to be honest.
And what do you desire
in the future,
right now and going into the future?
Desire now, enjoyable and fulfilling work, good work-life balance,
yeah,
good strong relationships around me. If that means as well, hopefully, like, again, it's not the be all and end all now, but hopefully then be comfortable knowing that, like, that you're okay and things are moving in the right direction, and then in the future, I'd say pretty similar. Just as in, again, if I'm one thing I think that's sort of over, I wouldn't say overlooked, it's definitely talked about, but just good mental health, good physical health, as in, because I've seen it in my life in terms of relations, and like, as in, you can be hit suddenly with illness, and as in, my granny used to always say that I've never seen a hearse with a trailer attached to it. Like, you can't bring it with you. Like, you can't bring anything with you to the next wherever we go after. Yeah. And there's, she says, there's no ATM in a graveyard. Like, is it, you know what I mean? In the sense that, like...
And you're born into this world with nothing, and you die with nothing.
Exactly.
So take it all as a...
Something. just try my best to enjoy the journey.
Yeah.
Try and meet some interesting people like yourself. That's
definitely my goal, to meet more James Finnegan.
You'll meet them in Georgia, in the mountains. enjoy the journey. Try and teach as much music as I can. Try and have plenty of banjo players around the world spreading the music. And
so finally, James, my last question for you is, what's the best piece of advice you've ever received?
Best piece of advice. We sort of touched on it earlier, and I think it's sort of, there's different ways of looking at it, but in terms of, like, if you're on the wrong bus, get off it. In the sense, if you're in life, and I understand there's definitely, it's not that easy. It's not easy just to be like, I'm on the wrong bus, get off it. It's in terms of, obviously, whether that's career, whether that's your college course, whether that's a friend group or whatever. But then, like, I wouldn't be a religious person, but the serenity prayer, in the sense of, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change and the courage to accept the things that I can and the wisdom to know the difference. Mm. I think that's really, really important. That's a really important lesson, that things happen in life. We all have our own crosses to bear. Shit happens. We have to learn to accept it. And then knowing that you can change things, that there is things in your life that you do have control over. And again, as in, I'm very early in this journey, so I think there's plenty I need to learn, and then the wisdom to know the difference, then just, again, that's your whole idea of reflecting, just thinking about things and not just accepting things just because that's the way it is. Just, I wouldn't necessarily say pushing back, but just being conscious of the world around you.
Exactly. Yeah? And listening
to banjo. No, listening.
Of course.
Yeah, so yeah, that's probably it.
Well, James, thanks a million for your insights, and absolutely, it's been awesome catching up.
Yeah, it was back a in the good reunion.
Exactly,
it's been too long. Yeah,
exactly. See you at graduation next week.
Next week, see you next Tuesday. No bother. Good luck.
Thanks, man.
Thanks for listening.
And that concludes this note or episode of Reflections. Thanks a million for listening, guys. I'm having a lot of fun reflecting along with people like James, and I hope you're learning something. If you felt that episode added some value into your life, please, please, please check out our link tree, which I'll chuck in the episode description below, where you're able to find our book, Reflections, the Student View, our Instagram account, podcast material, and more. And see you next time. Thanks a million, guys.